Sheep's in the meadow, cows in the corn. Now is the time for a child to be born. Laugh at the moon and he'll cry for the sun. And if it's a boy, he'll carry a gun, sang the crow. On the cradle. And if it should be that this baby's a girl, never you mind if her hair doesn't curl. It rings on her fingers, and bells on her toes, and a bomber above her, wherever sang the crow on the cradle. The crow on the cradle, the black and the white, somebody's baby is born for a fight. The crow on the cradle, the white and somebody's baby is not coming back, sang the crow on the cradle. Mother and father, they'll sweat and they'll say, to build you a coffin and dig you a grave. Hush up, my little one, never you be, for we've got a toy that can put you to sleep, sang the crow. Shoot that bird dead. That's what your mother and father once said. Crow on the cradle, what can we do? Oh, this is a thing that I leave up to you, sang the crow on the cradle. Ah, this is a thing that I leave up to you, sang the crow on the cradle.
All right, Mr. Echo, you may begin.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Honor, Commonwealth calls its first witness Richard Moravec, Captain of Security at General Electric. How long have you been at security at GE?
22 years.
And what building are you assigned to?
Building 9, Reentry Division, King of Prussia.
Directing your attention to September 9th, 1980, do you recall at 6:30 a.m. or thereabouts what, if anything unusual, happened?
Yes, a man dressed as a priest entered the building and a woman accompanied him.
Are either of those two in the courtroom today?
Yes, they are.
The two that are standing, can you identify them?
Father Cabot, Montgomery's sister.
Then what happened, if anything?
Well, Father Cabot grabbed me by my arms and pinned me against the wall when I picked up the phone. Miss Montgomery tried to get the phone off me and held her hand on the receiver so I couldn't make my phone call.
Who are you attempting to call?
My superior, Mr. Bauman.
Okay. Now, would you describe for the jury exactly how you were held?
Well, my desk was here and the phone was here. I picked up the phone with my left hand. Father Cabot had his hands on my upper arms and I was against the wall this way.
And what did Sister Anne Montgomery do?
Well, she kept trying to get the phone away from me. She held her hand down on the receiver so the phone call wouldn't go through. She kept saying, don't call, don't call.
Okay. Then describe what you observed after that.
Well, at the time I was being held, six other people entered the building. They went into the inner doors a single file.
Did you say anything to these people?
Yes. I told them they were unauthorized not to enter the building, that it was private property.
And in response to what you said to them, did they do anything?
No. They just kept on walking through the doors. After that, I opened the double doors of the high bay area. I heard this loud clanging, like metal beating against metal. To me, it sounded like 50-gallon drums being beaten on.
Did you go to where you heard the noise?
As we got closer to room 1650, the noise got louder.
Okay. Is that the non-destructive test room?
That's non-destructive test room, yes. I saw these people, bunch of people with hammers beating on the metal there, and...
Describe what you observed.
Well, to me, it looked like this bunch of crazy people beating on metal in this room. I particularly noticed that young lady there who had a hammer. With both hands, she was really beating on this metal structure.
Molly Rush?
Yes.
Stars were still in the sky.
Stars were out.
Dark.
Well, we had two cars for the eight of us. And we had arrived a little bit early.
So
45 minutes
early.
45 minutes early. We didn't want to be late. So we were sitting in the Howard Johnson's parking lot, deep breathing like crazy. With our hearts beating, right?
I was perfectly calm at that point.
Were you?
I think I was the only one that wasn't nervous because I'd been so nervous all the way up until then. When I woke up that morning, I was just completely at ease.
We had our hammers concealed in a pocketbook, or mine was hanging underneath my arm, my t-shirt. We then approached the building in this way and came in through the parking lot.
Which was mostly empty at the time.
Mostly empty, yeah. And of course, we had rehearsed all of this and role-played it. And knew exactly where each car was going to park and who would get out and go in what order.
Here we are at the Reentry Systems Division, Operational Manufacturing Center. Who would ever know it was a center for manufacture of nuclear warheads from that name? We felt it was very important to time it so that the more quickly things proceeded, the more likely it was we'd get in.
We came right around here and parked.
Okay, hold on. This door?
This door. This is where all the workers come in.
This is where I went in. There's four on either side, up the steps. And through the door on the right-hand side, I believe it was. And inside is the security guard's desk. If anything, that was the thing that thrust me into this action. Because I'm a housewife, I have six children,
I don't think people could perceive me as some kind of a, you know, heroine figure or something unreal. I think I'm the kind of person that, you know, I think I could talk to groups of people and they could relate to and understand me for a person that cares about her kids.
Father Carl Cabot and Ann Montgomery led the way. They went inside and introduced themselves to the security guard who was at a little desk. They shook his hand, they introduced themselves, said that they were there for nonviolent, peaceful purposes. Meanwhile, what we were doing was walking around right behind them and through the second door. The guard, I could see him looking at us with some question, but before he had time to react, I think we were all inside, the six of us. Carl was right with the guard, and Anne had her hand at the telephone. The guard immediately sensed that something was going on that wasn't the normal opening of the regular day at that plant, and so he went to the telephone. And as he reached for the phone, he made it clear that he was going to, you know, get hold of that phone, and rather than resist him, left the phone alone and turned around and came and followed us inside. So at that point, there were seven of us inside the building. Carl, meanwhile, stayed out and continued to engage conversation with the guard, who then put him in a bear hug.
Okay. Now, at that point, were they doing any singing?
At that point, they stopped and they all joined hands and they started to chant hymns, I guess. I don't know. I wasn't listening. I know it was something. Anyway, at that time, I said, everybody out this way. They all filed out. We went down the passageway toward the rear lobby, and as we were going along the passageway, there were these white steel drums lined up along the right side of the passageway, and they each had white pamphlets on the steel drums. And that time I noted the third person in front of me lunge for a secret tag was on one of these pamphlets and started to rip it in two. That time I lunged forward to grab, you know, take it out of his grasp, which I did.
Do you recall who that was?
Yes, it was Philip Berrigan. That time I said, that's private property. He said, that's people's property.
Okay. Now, when you observed that section of the building, in what state or condition was it?
It was blood all over the pavement, floors, and paperwork, and there was one piece of hardware. It was aluminum, had holes punched in it.
Did you see any of the midsections, if you observed them?
One piece of...
Your Honor, Mr. Souchard is interrupting me.
Well, describe what you mean by this aluminum piece with the holes in it, if you can.
Well, it's shaped like a funnel-shaped piece of aluminum.
What's it used for?
Objection, Your Honor.
I am security only. I have no idea what these products consist of or what they're used for. I am strictly security. We were supposed to guard General Electric property.
Property? What property? What is it?
I didn't ask what the property was. My job is security.
Has General Electric told people like Captain Morbeck what they're guarding in plant number 9? What they're protecting? Have you been informed by General Electric concerning the so-called property there?
And these certainly are not questions of philosophy, they're questions of fact. He should know what he's guarding and be able to tell us.
That question was never asked.
It was asked.
No, it wasn't. You may call your next witness, Mr. Eckel.
Mr. Bauman, by whom are you employed?
General Electric.
And how long have you been...
Manager of shop operations.
And how long have you been employed by GE?
20 years.
Okay, I show you Commonwealth Exhibit 58, and I ask you, can you identify that?
Yes, I can.
And what is that?
That is what we call the mid-shield, or shell, rather. It's the aluminum structure.
Okay. And is that what you observed some of the seven, or some of the eight, striking?
Yes, I did.
Okay, now, if you look at this exhibit, it looks as though there are various indentations, marks, what have you.
Your Honor, we're willing to stipulate all this. I don't know what he's adding to what we've already admitted.
We admit that we banged it.
They're for the benefit of the jury.
Well, is there any way you can swallow it so the audience could know?
But the audience is not relevant for the audience. It's only relevant for the jury. We're not playing first-run theater here.
It is a public trial, isn't it?
Okay, when you went in there and observed them, exactly what did you observe them doing? And would you describe it for the members of the jury?
Well, as I say, there was this woman beating on the hardware, blood on the floor, at least what I thought was blood. And these people were having a lusty old time smashing the hardware, beating on it with both hands, some with both hands, some with the right hand, some with one hand. I'm not certain that they used their left hands or not.
Okay, and how long was it after that everything stopped?
Oh, I would say after about 5 seconds, everything was over.
And what items were damaged?
Two structures we call midsections.
Directing your attention to C6. Do you recognize these midsections as being thermonuclear warheads?
I can't answer that.
You are not aware that they contain 335 kilotons?
I do not recognize that.
A thermonuclear device?
No, I do not.
And you've worked for General Electric for how long?
Over 20 years.
20 years.
That's right.
And how long have you worked at plant number 9?
About 13 years.
13 years.
That's right.
And how long has plant number 9 been in the production of Mark 12, Mark 12A, or the Mark 500?
10 years.
10 years. And throughout that time, you were not aware that these are thermonuclear...
Would you ask me that question again?
Which question? Can you restate it and answer it yourself?
You asked me to identify that as a nuclear warhead.
Yes.
I can't do that.
You think it's being used for kitchenware?
That retort of question will be stricken from the record. It is not responsive and not questioning and irrelevant.
You must think it's being used for something.
We are not going to have any speeches here, Reverend. I'm telling you that right now. I'm not going to have this sort of disruption.
Mr. Bowman, from your work at GE or from what you've been told by the company, are you familiar with what is being manufactured at plant number 9?
I can't answer that.
Well, what's your capacity vis-a-vis this non-destructible testing area?
Well, my responsibility is to manufacture the hardware. Okay? We are not a nuclear facility. It is not a nuclear facility.
Are you familiar with some of the characteristics of the Mark 12A?
Objection, Your Honor.
Overruled.
Characteristics of the Mark 12A.
Yes, I said the Mark 12A.
I don't know what you mean by that. There are a lot of different characteristics. As far as the flight characteristics, I have no idea.
I mean the main characteristics. It's a first strike weapon, isn't it?
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained.
I don't know anything about the first strike capability of this.
And yet you've been working for GE for 20 years.
That's right.
And I suspect you've been working on a whole range of thermonuclear weaponry.
Objection, Your Honor.
I know nothing about thermonuclear warheads. I've never seen a nuclear warhead.
Do you have any familiarity with the payload or the explosive yield of the Mark 12A, this weapon?
I know nothing about the specific uses of the Mark 12A. All I do is manufacture hardware, okay? We are not a nuclear facility.
General Electric has never informed you about the intent or the purpose of that weapon?
No.
Mr. Bowman, do you have security clearance at General Electric?
I certainly do.
Uh-huh. And could you say something about the nature of that security clearance?
Objection, Your Honor. It's not relevant.
Your Honor.
Your Honor.
Wait a minute. Let me rule. I mean, after all, we've got to have some decorum here.
This question, Your Honor, goes to the heart of his responsibility to this court, his understanding of his employment, his own job.
Yes, and he answered what he knew.
Amazing.
When you say hardware, Mr. Bowman, are you referring to the Mark 12A?
That's correct.
And is that the general vocabulary that's used at plant number 9?
That's right.
And are the workers there specifically forbidden to refer to the Mark 12A?
They don't refer to nuclear warheads, and they know nothing about nuclear warheads.
Well, show him what.
Do you maybe know where the shells are delivered to?
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained.
Highly irrelevant. We're trying...
It may be a matter of national security. The question will not go answered.
Not a matter of my security. Is this what is called sterilizing the evidence?
Objection, Your Honor. Motion to strike.
Granted.
I'd like to find out the nature of the oath or the promise that he made in General Electric. Because it's germane, it's essential to find that out in relation to the oath that he took here. Which one supersedes? I want to find out the difference between, let's say, his ignorance of this hideous weapon.
Well, now, look, we're not making speeches here, Reverend. If you wanted to find out what his security was,
and on the other hand,
that is relevant.
Good.
But not any oaths that he takes.
Let's go on that. I don't know what oath he took. I don't know whether he swore on the Bible for GE.
That doesn't make any difference. The question is what the security clearance imports to it.
Maybe his promise to GE supersedes this one. I don't know. I think we have to find out which oath takes precedence in the courtroom.
We are not trying oaths in this courtroom. We are trying acts, your acts.
Are you allowed to talk to your family about what you do at GE?
No. They recommend that we do not.
Do you consider that that promise or recommendation is superseded by the oath you took in the court?
No.
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained.
Your Honor, the jury are among the few in the world
objection,
that will
Your Honor.
See such weapons before they're used on people. I was wondering, very few in their whole lives get to see a nuclear weapon like this.
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained. We are not making any speeches about these weapons or whether they are in fact weapons.
Is that a joke?
No, it is not a joke. It seems to be a pathetic mistake so far.
Pathetic mistake? You mean building the weapon?
This weapon has been referred to as a 335-kiloton weapon. I would like very much to clear up that term. After all, this term has been used 4 or 5 times.
I don't recall any testimony that there was 335,000 tons.
I don't either.
Well, we used the term. We used that term several times, and they listened to it, that is, the jury did, and it wasn't objected to by the prosecutor.
I think it's been objected to many times.
Why? Why? Is it true or isn't
it? Because it's not relevant.
Not relevant?
Not relevant.
Whether you know it to be true or not isn't relevant. The proper person to elicit this from is some engineer.
Expert testimony. We'll get expert testimony.
Meanwhile, the jury is mystified by all of this.
Your Honor, may I make a motion? It's just occurred to me that you referred in front of a jury to our action of September 10th as a, quotes, pathetic mistake. And this in the presence of the jury.
I did not. I said from the testimony so far, it appears to be a pathetic mistake.
It seems to me that this was a most prejudicial remark to make in the presence of the jury. I think at this point, you should declare a mistrial.
Are you making a motion? Motion denied. I made no such outburst or any kind of a statement whatsoever about this trial.
I would like to undertake this part of the service by burning this ridiculous indictment, for God's sake.
Amen. Amen.
Phil, you help me. This is burglary. Let us burn it. For God's sake.
Amen.
This is criminal trespass. Let us burn it for God's sake.
Amen.
This is the next lie. Let me see here. Oh, repeated hammer blows or criminal mischief.
Amen.
Burn it. This is, let me see, in dishonor of, criminal trespass.
Hey,
anyone remember any of these other idiots? Give me another one.
Kidnapping.
Burning, for God's sake. Assault. Burning, for God's sake.
Mischief. Conspiracy.
Rico.
Treason.
Is that the indictment to you?
Yes.
Beautiful.
The ink smokes for some reason.
It's demonic. What else do we have? Anything else around?
This is 27 years worth of GE cards.
All right.
Investigation of a car.
Burn it, for God's sake. Here we have an omnibus motion written in good faith and trampled on by the courts of injustice. That is, burn it, for God's sake.
Burn it, for God's sake.
Truth will out.
This is money which has enslaved us all at one time. We heard again and again on the stand yesterday how people have sold their birthright for a little bit of money. The birthright is the right of conscience.
Burn it, for God's sake.
This is a draft status card that has been contributed and dedicated to and for this occasion.
It's burning. Burn it, for God's sake.
We'd like to go to the jail now for a moment of prayer.
Maybe we do something to prevent that which would cause nuclear ash.
What they're saying now is that the times are even more dangerous than they were in the 50s and the 60s. And I do not believe that they'll get a fair trial because of the criminal system of justice in this country. That's one of the great myths of this country. When I had my bail revoked in the Chicago conspiracy trial and went to Cook County Jail, I found that 96 or 97% of the inmates were black or Spanish or Oriental. And unless you have some kind of absurd racist attitude that thinks that it was in their genes, you know that it's the injustice of the society and the injustice of the courts. So I think their best hope for a fair trial is through the support of the people who already support them and other people who know enough to be afraid. Afraid of the danger of nuclear war and afraid of what's happening to the society.
Battery.
Identify yourself, please.
I'm Officer J. Bowling, Upper Marion Police.
And did you drive the defendants to the police station?
Yes, I did.
At the police station, what, if anything, did you observe or hear?
Well, as we were taking the people from the police van into the police station, there was a young man walking nearby.
Had you seen that young man before?
No, I'd never seen him before. He was later identified as Matthew Horowitz. And Mr. Cabot stated to
him... Is that Father Cabot?
Yes, Father Cabot said, we got some of those nose cones. We got them good. He was then placed in one of the detaining rooms.
Father Cabot, are you aware of what that means, that statement in front of the jury?
It means the fact that we got those warheads good, yes.
All right.
Well, actually, we're happy we destroyed them. I mean...
I'm just trying to protect you, gentlemen. I think you're translating that earlier phrase of yours, pathetic mistake.
Objection, Your Honor.
It will be stricken. Officer Bowling.
At the time you arrested us, I think the charges were trespassing and mischief.
At that time, that was the knowledge I had. That's
right.
What you were placed under arrest for.
Right. And yet it says here that by the end of that day, we were facing 13 charges. And I'd like to ask, at whose suggestion and direction were those charges multiplied?
Other authorities were called into the case, sir.
And would you name those other authorities?
The district attorney's office, the county detective's office, and the FBI was notified.
And the FBI. And were you in on the conference that multiplied these charges?
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained.
Really? Sustained. Two charges in the morning, 13 by the evening. And this is the story of the poor who are in jail here, as well as ourselves.
And we suggest that these multiple and fabricated charges are for the sake of confusing the jury.
Your Honor, the defendants are not being treated any differently than the defendants in any criminal case.
Every single defendant in this county has their rights violated over and over again. The charges are multiplied. This is one of the rottenest prosecution offices that I've ever been exposed to. And for you to give your rubber stamp of approval to this kind of violation of constitutional rights is a disgrace.
Mr. Shoeshot, I don't have to remind you that criticism of the bench and the exercise of its duty is in direct contempt, and I'm not going to warn you again, mister. Now, that is blasphemous and could have been edited in direct contempt right here and now.
We had prepared briefs. Norm Townsend is sitting with me from Washington, and Norm did the brief on justification that we submitted to the judge.
It's very straightforward defense. It's not any esoteric or exotic defense that the judge would have trouble understanding. Had this been a case where somebody was holding the gun to your head and you hurt that person or destroyed the gun, you would have been permitted to, in a criminal trial, to say why you destroyed that gun, why you destroyed damaged property, rather, by saying that person had a gun to my head and it could have gone off. The United States...
Make that metaphor more precise. Okay, you're about...
Well, the United States has a gun at everybody's head in this country. Every human being living in the world has a gun pointed at its head. And that gun could go off any moment. And we wanted to be permitted to show the jury that that gun is pointed at their heads, that it's pointed at our heads. And it's not unreasonable for these people to act in a way to remove that gun, to destroy that gun, and to present that in a way that's codified by Pennsylvania statute. And the judge just arbitrarily, without any argument on the motion, without hearing from anybody, decided that what we wanted to do was totally irrelevant to this case. He would have permitted it had you been charged with shooting somebody or hurting somebody. You would have been permitted to say, that person was going to hurt me. And that's all that these defendants wanted to say. Had the evidence, I'm not quite sure what the judge feared. Was he so fearful that this jury was hearing this evidence, would have found these people not guilty? If that's what he's afraid of, then he has really perverted the criminal justice system in this country. Because if he's fearful that the jury would have let them go, then what do we have juries for?
All right, some of you have an opening statement. Can I know who's going to open?
I am, Your Honor.
Outline your defense.
All right, Your Honor. There are clear questions we want to deal with in terms of the law. One of the questions is intent. If you find that our intention was not criminal, then you must find us not guilty. We will prove that we knowingly, willfully, and consciously acted in order to protect and to save the life of the human family. And that when we went into GE, into that plant, our intent was not a criminal intent. Then there's a question of justification, which means that we only need to prove that we entertained a reasonable belief.
Objection, Your Honor. Once again, she's getting into the law.
Yes, just indicate what your defense is going to be.
She's not a legal expert, she's a human being.
Thank you, Daniel.
She's being forbidden a human language.
We have GE employees, Your Honor, using words to describe these as products, hardware, shells, shields and shells, nose cones, none of which, I think, communicate the awful terror.
Objection, Your Honor.
We will be presenting evidence with our expert witnesses as to the terrible, numbing effect that nuclear weapons have on all of us as human beings.
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained.
I'm talking, Your Honor, about a witness that we intend to bring before the court who is an expert on...
Objection, Your Honor.
We will be bringing in expert witnesses, such as Robert Aldridge, to give you information about the kind of harm and the evil that we were trying to avoid. We will be presenting testimony...
Objection, Your Honor.
...from an international law expert at Princeton, Richard Falk, which makes clear that the principles of international law are binding in a Pennsylvania courtroom. We're arguing in Pennsylvania that GE King of Prussia and that the people who operate that plant are bound by international law, just as the German citizens and the people who operated the death camp operations during World War II were bound in principle to follow standards of international law.
Dear friends, it's my privilege today to speak to you as simply and directly as I can about a few words that you will have heard and will hear repeatedly in this courtroom. The first of these words is property. You've heard it applied to these, and yet I submit to you this morning that applying a word like property to that is a degradation and a disgrace. Because property certainly refers to whatever enhances, nourishes, cherishes, builds human life or human community. Now, strangely, in this courtroom, you're going to hear that noble word applied to those horrors. I suggest to you, members of the jury, that those things have nothing to do with what is proper to human beings, that they are anti-property. And those, what shall I call them? You've heard about hammers and blood in this room. These are the hammers of hell. These are the hammers that will break the world to bits. These are the hammers that clang the end of the world. The judge knows it. The prosecutor knows it. We've seen people walk away from these things. We've seen them disclaim them. We've seen them say they're not responsible for them. We've seen all sorts of language circling them like a dance of death. They are murdered. He knows it. He knows it. You must know it. We have been trying, we eight, to take responsibility for these things, to call them by their right name, which is murder, death, genocide, the end of the world. Their proper use is known to the judge and the prosecutor, and to you. We know, in fact, that calling things by their name is a very noble and human endeavor.
You know that when you hold a child in your arms and name that child, you are saying, we are responsible for you. We take that responsibility in arms. That is what naming you means. They misname those. They walk away. They close their hearts, they close their pocketbooks, they take their check, and they go home. These things belong to someone. They belong to us. In the sense of responsibility, we must say they are ours. We are willing to say they pollute our world. They do not belong in our world. We are going to be responsible for them. We would like you to know the name of our crime. We would like to assume responsibility for a world, for children, for the future. And if that is a crime, then it is quite clear that we belong in their jails. Where they belong is something else. But in the name of all the eight, I would like to leave with you, friends and jurors, that great and noble word, which is our crime, responsibility.
Members of the jury, the government has presented 13 witnesses who have testified that they don't know what these exhibits are. In our defense, we will be calling 8 expert witnesses who will testify with particularity as to the fact that these are thermonuclear warheads.
Objection, Your Honor.
Robert Aldridge.
Objection, Your Honor.
An engineer with Lockheed for 16 years will specify that these are first strike nuclear weapons. Each
Objection,
one of
Your
them
Honor.
Capable of 25 to 30 times the destructive capacity of Hiroshima.
Objection, Your Honor.
Objection sustained. We are going to outline your defense, Mr. Shushard, not what your evidence intends to show. We just want to know what your defense is.
What's the difference,
the
Your
difference
Honor?
The difference is that nuclear warfare is not on trial here. You are.
Your Honor, at this time, we would like to call as a witness Robert Aldridge.
I would object to that.
Who is this Robert Aldridge?
He was a scientist with Lockheed for 16 years and helped develop 5 generations of strategic weapons.
Your Honor, I would object on the basis of relevancy. I don't see how it's relevant to the criminal charges that were brought against these defendants. He's not a fact witness.
All right, my ruling is that he may not testify. It is irrelevant as to being a fact witness in this case.
Your Honor, during a voir dire, I think you said that this would be the proper time to present this kind of fact. You talked about justification.
The reason why it is not allowed is on the grounds of relevancy. Mark 12As are not on trial here, nor is the fact that they are or aren't nuclear warheads on trial. You are on trial.
Your Honor, the jury sits there knowing that the defendants had planned and that the court has recognized that the defendants had planned to present this defense of justification. Now, throughout all this time, the court has never questioned us on the law of justification. Nor has it asked for any arguments on justification. In fact, you have not even requested a brief on it. So I must say, Your Honor, it comes as a complete surprise to these defendants to be told now, just before our first justification witness, that this avenue of defense is no longer open to us. Justification has been mentioned scores and scores of times, Your Honor, before these jurors. Now we find out that it's not going to be allowed, completely cut off, no evidence admitted, no word at all.
All right, I've heard your speech. My ruling is as follows.
Your Honor, we are entitled to argue this. You only call it a speech because you're terribly prejudiced.
I am not prejudiced.
Your Honor, you have not read our briefs. You have not studied it. You do not know the law.
I do know the law. I certainly do know the law. You are going to nuclear warheads here, and that is not relevant.
I see. Well, then we're not to have any argument at all.
That's right.
Your Honor, I believe you said we would be able to argue it. Oral argument, Your Honor.
That's our understanding, Judge. Well, I changed my mind. My ruling still stands.
What is your ruling?
My ruling is that the testimony will not be proffered. It is not relevant.
Judge, The evidence here is not a Saturday night special. These are thermonuclear weapons. We ought to have a public trial, a full, open hearing on these issues.
It was a legal ruling, and it will not be argued in front of the jury. The jury well understands that I make rulings of law, and that's what it was. Now let's continue.
This is Robert Aldridge, who is a former Lockheed engineer.
Well, my testimony would have covered the nature of the Mark 12A warhead, what it is intended for.
Speak up.
My testimony would have covered the nature of the Mark 12A warhead and what it is intended for. These MX missiles, Minuteman III missiles, equipped with Mark 12A warheads are likely to accomplish exactly what they're advertised to prevent. They're likely to cause a Soviet strike, and they're likely to cause World War III. And in this sense, I can only conclude, after 24 years of designing missiles and reentry vehicles and researching these, that these are first strike nuclear weapons.
Thank you, Bob Aldridge. Next, we have George Wald, who is the winner of the Nobel Prize in 1967 for biology and is also a member of the executive committee of the Federation of American Scientists.
I was going to say that what brought a biologist here is a concern for life. Life has never been as threatened in the entire history of this planet as it is at present. The situation can be put to you very plainly and clearly. The present stockpiles of just the so-called strategic nuclear weapons, those are the big ones, more or less in the megaton, a million tons of TNT range. The present stockpiles in the United States and Soviet Union add up to the explosive force of about 16 billion tons of TNT. There are about 4 billion people on the Earth. That means 4 tons of TNT for every man, woman, and child on the Earth. In addition, both sides have already stockpiled tens of thousands of so-called tactical nuclear weapons and have already stockpiled the material for hundreds of thousands more. So I better tell you what a tactical nuclear weapon is. The bomb that in a moment leveled the city of Hiroshima and by the end of that year, 1945, had killed 140,000 people, rates in the present nuclear arsenals as a rather small tactical weapon. There is a good chance by now that we've already stockpiled all the hardware necessary to wipe out the human race and much of the rest of life on this planet. It would be, in the course of evolution of life on this planet, the first do-it-yourself extinction.
I would have testified as to the relevance of international law to the defense that these eight individuals are trying to make in court, particularly the essence of their beliefs that led them to do what they did was the feeling that the kind of nuclear weapons and the kinds of nuclear policies that the United States government is currently pursuing violate international law and violate the kinds of principles that were established at the Nuremberg judgment by which individuals are responsible for their acts in relation to international law. This, in my judgment, goes to the essence of a fair legal trial.
Can we just finish?
I'd like you to take it downstairs otherwise.
And finally, I would have talked about a summary sense of what would happen to people, potential survivors, if there were any, of a nuclear war, pointing out that the present bombs are 100 to 1,000 times the size of the baby Hiroshima bomb, and also that we can expect no outside world to come in and rebuild a city that's been bombed, as one had in Hiroshima, which was the only reason why Hiroshima could be rebuilt. And finally, that when people talk about what it would be like to survive a nuclear war for those few survivors, if any, and they say, as a number of world leaders have said, the survivors would envy the dead, even that doesn't go far enough. I would go further and say that the survivors would feel themselves as if dead. The survivors would not really feel alive. They would be essentially immobilized, stunned, living less than a half-life. In other words, there is no psychological capacity to prepare for or survive nuclear war.
Yes, you are.
In somebody's way. We decide where you are in somebody's way.
Look, I'll give you everything you want. You got plenty of room down there. You got people here to operate on these windows, okay? I'm not saying that you'll take them down there from here on in. My men are going to be notified of this thing from here. They're going to move you down. I'm not stopping you to take all the interviews you want. I don't care if you're there to Timbuktu. But it'll be down there, okay? Thank you.
Father Berrigan will take the stand now. Father Berrigan, I'd like to ask you a simple question. Why did you do what you did to these?
The question of Sister Anne, dear friends, brings up words that you have already heard frequently in this court and will hear again. Great words. Words like conscience and justification and community. I would like, by way of telling my story, to begin with the formation of a young child's conscience. In a family that was poor, in which the parents lived what they taught and taught by living it, in which the good was done because it was good, in which, as far as I can remember, there were no crooked lines, but a straight understanding of who we were in the world. The second influence, and one which abides really to this moment, is the influence of my religious order. At 18, I entered the Jesuits. And I reflect that in May, I was 60 years old, which means, I guess, that I have never really been anything in my adult life except a priest and a Jesuit. And I think this morning of all those Jesuit priests throughout Latin America who are also in courtrooms, who are under torture and in prison and murdered, and whose images, whose pictures are on the walls of homes of the poor, venerated because they stood by their people and stood by God and believed in something in tough times. I say these things because I think all of the eight would have you realize that we come from somewhere, that our conscience is not operating in a void, that we come from long years of life in community, from a common discipline and a common faith and prayer, and that we would like to consider you a community of conscience meeting our community to see if some light may be shed upon a desperately dark time. You have been called in this court the conscience of the community. I'm wondering what questions arise in good consciences these days. It seems to me that one way of putting the question that brought us here, you could put it many ways, so could we. But maybe this will start. What is to happen to the children of the world if these things continue? Is there going to be a human future? Is there going to be a next generation? These are desperately grave questions in the light of these weapons. Because they foreclose the future, they foreclose the lives of children. They're absolutely indiscriminate in their power of destruction. They don't even deserve the word weapon. They are some nameless horror aimed at life. What do we do in such times? I think the eight will tell their story of what we tried to do, where we tried to go, where our consciences impelled us. The direction has not been easy. And again, I speak for myself. I would put it this way. I could not do what I did. I use a deliberately clumsy phrase that I hope you can grab. I could not do this thing. It speaks of a kind of a blow in the back that says, take the next step. A step that you don't want to take. A step that every cowardly bone in your body says, don't take. I must say to you, and the confession is not particularly appealing or a proud one. Every time I'm arrested, my stomach turns over. I want not to do it. I want not to move in that direction. I don't do particularly well in jail. I hate the humiliation. I hate the degradation of it all, the scene in which human life is so devalued and devoured. And yet one goes forward. One cannot not do what must be done, especially with the kind of background that I have tried to share with you. Well, so we came to this hour, which has been told of again and again, September 9th, and in a very modest and carefully calibrated way, being careful about the human lives involved, the guards and the others, we went into that plant and did something which evidently is highly charged in the public mind, in the judicial mind, something symbolic, poured our own blood over these monstrous objects, dented them, and stood around praying and singing until the law came and we were whisked off. It's a very simple story. It involved harm to no one, in spite of any claim that it did. We did what we could not do.
Could you say something about what your work or how your work at the cancer hospital in New York influenced what you did?
Surely. Sister Anne refers to the fact that for the past 3 years, I guess, I've been working with the dying part-time in New York City. This is a hospital where we only take those who cannot pay, cannot be received elsewhere. The poor of the city, the street folks, all ages, all colors, all conditions. I wonder how many of the jury have really smelled and touched cancer up close. It's not a very appealing smell or sight. Cancer of the brain, cancer of the face, cancer of the tongue, cancer of the limbs. It has a great relevance to this because we have a mounting evidence now in this country and across the world that at the flashpoint, whether its word is Hiroshima or New York City or Moscow or anywhere else in the world, many thousands will die and many thousands will live dying. We know, in fact, that according to this calculation, cancer is the vocation of the human family. And those who do not die at the flashpoint will die and die and die for years of cancer. I could not enter that hospital without understanding the Pentagon. And without having spoken to those dying folk of why people like myself and others who worked there went from St. Rose's home in New York by direct line to the Pentagon to object to and to resist what was being planned there in our name, cancer as a universal plague. This, I submit, dear friends, is intolerable. That the world should be so wasted in the disservice to human life and in the service of the gods of death, and the talent and money and the sweet earth should be pounded down a rat hole which seems to have no end, the military.
Getting to the action itself, could you say a word about our preparation for it?
Surely. Sister Anne's question really touches back on the earlier references I made to community. We have really never gone into anything as serious as this action without serious spiritual preparation. We have always spent at least one day of prayer and often two and three before such actions together, searching out the will of God in our regard, trying to decide together what burdens we could bear, trying to lay out our fears before one another in the light of God's will, and to dispose of those fears, at least to the point where we could take the next step. But I'm happy for the question again, because it enables you to know us better, to know that we are not flagrant or vagrant or people who do things on the spur of the moment or by whim. We try to be as serious about the children of the world as the parents of the children of the world would want us to be. At the end of those 3 days, it seemed to be apparent to the eight who stood at this table that we were to move, we were to take that step, we were to take those consequences. And so here we are.
These questions are very short. Have you ever physically harmed anyone?
No.
Would you ever, for any reason, injure another person?
No.
Would you ever, by word or gesture, threaten to injure another person?
No, I would not.
Thank you.
You may cross-examine.
Do you know whose property you damaged?
Pardon?
Do you know whose property it was?
Well, first of all, we didn't consider those things property. We considered them, as I've tried to explain here at some length, as anti-proper, anti-human. But I guess I've said all
but
that.
But it's being referred to as property. Do you know whose they were?
Well, we knew that those nuclear weapons are our responsibility, and we tried to do something about them.
You didn't know whose they were.
They shouldn't be anyone's. They shouldn't exist.
But knowing they do exist, whose weapons are they?
Good God, I don't know. No one at General Electric would claim them.
You say that you're not violent.
Right?
By not violent, you mean you don't hit people?
Well, that's a pretty depressing thought.
Don't you think using a hammer on an object is violent?
Well, not if the object, as you call it, is a nuclear weapon. Now, if these things had been filled with ping pong balls or buttermilk, I'd have left them alone.
You say some laws you respect and some laws you don't. I think your testimony was that you respect and obey some laws, and some laws you don't.
Well, Mr. Eccle, I think you put things rather badly. What I really said was that if the human law contravenes the law of God, I will break the human law to keep the divine law.
All right, if you finish with your cross-examination, we'll have a lunch recess until 2 o'clock.
I want to speak the truth about the Mark 12A.
Your assertions aren't necessarily based on fact.
He's trying to describe a weapon that can be found in any GE handbook. Well, what's objected to?
Your Honor, they are not on trial for opposing nuclear weapons.
We are, in fact, on trial for opposing nuclear weapons. The only reason we are in this courtroom today is that we have carried out an action that is intended to call attention to the perils of the arms.
Your Honor, I object once again.
Objection sustained.
Elmer, use your own judgment. Continuing under this harassment or stopping?
Sure, whatever you want.
Well, when you look at these instruments here, these Mark 12As, what would be the actual power of one of them?
This instrument.
Objection, Your Honor.
The Nuremberg principles, which have influenced me.
Wait a minute, please. But I sustained an objection, Mr. Moss. The Nuremberg principles are not relevant.
They are precisely relevant. From the point of view that we are all, it is incumbent upon every citizen.
Don't give me a speech. I said it wasn't relevant.
Okay. Let me spell out exactly what has influenced me. I have been influenced by the book Counterforce Syndrome, by Robert Aldrich.
Objection, Your Honor.
By the book Nuclear Madness, by Helen Caldicott. I have been influenced by books on international law, by Richard Falk. I have been influenced by the Pentagon Papers, by Daniel Ellsberg. I've been influenced by the writings of George Wald and by the writings of Robert J. Lifton, all of whom have been called here to testify. And it is a testament to the suppression of truth in this courtroom that these witnesses were not allowed to testify and that you were not allowed to hear what they had to say?
I think I allowed, with some degree of liberality, first of all, some criticism directed at the court from the witness stand, which was, in my opinion, contemptuous.
No, Your Honor, I think it goes to his understanding.
No, no. You are trying to get in the back door, that which you cannot get in the front.
No, no, Your Honor. We are trying to get in the front door what belongs properly in the front door. That is an aid to this man's understanding.
You made your point, denied. That's it.
As an officer of this court, Your Honor, I'm trying to bring clarity to the witness's statements. I think that Elmer Moss needs a little help in making the point he's trying to make.
Yes, he has needed a little assistance all throughout this trial in getting to his point.
Your Honor, I believe that that is undignified and should be stricken from the record.
Undignified? It's completely prejudicial.
No, it isn't.
Your Honor, the law in the Commonwealth is clear. And it is that a defendant has the right to testify broadly.
He certainly does.
Oh, good, then he can explain the Mark 12A.
No, he cannot explain the Mark 12A's. He can explain his justification and his personal conscience as he saw it.
Oh, justification and conscience. Then what would one of these, let's say, dropped on New York City or maybe Philadelphia, that is pertinent, I'm sure. Just one of them.
No, he is on trial for the charges which I indicated at the beginning of this trial.
Your Honor, I think he should be permitted to testify as to his understanding of Dr. Falk's writing. If he can't do that, then he is not being allowed to testify.
Your argument is noted. Denied. Does Mr. Moss want to continue or not? Please return to the witness stand. Mr. Moss, do you want to continue? Would you please return to the stand?
I do not plan to return to that stand until there is an opportunity for a full hearing of the issues in this case based upon the kind of defense that is legitimate and available to us under the laws of this state and this country.
All right, that is your choice. You may think about it for a few minutes. All right, Mr. Moss, do you want to return to the stand?
No, I do not. No.
Very well. Then your testimony will be concluded at this time. All right, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, we will adjourn.
Carl Cabot, John Shushard, and myself came here to the General Electric building where we had come originally in September because we feel that in the spirit of that action, this is where the truth needs to be told.
I think perhaps you ought to take a statement from Bishop Priya.
I want to say that I am in full solidarity with the Plowshares aid. If I have been with them here, I would have gone into the GE2 and hammered those cones.
Will you be going back to the courtroom at all?
We'll remain here for a certain time. And if the police want to pick the four of us up, that is Father Cabot, myself, Elmer Moss, John Shushard, see, then that's their prerogative. We'll wait for them.
Get up there.
You're building nuclear bombs here that can kill and destroy the earth and all that
is finished. Go to Russia and tell them.
We are coming and we're going to kill.
private property.
Hey, Valerie, there are better scenes for an arrest.
Private property, get up there.
Right on!
There you go, Valerie.
Examine your conscience, Robert Hartman. Examine your conscience.
Private property will kill us all.
How did you get the message?
I was in the courtroom, and what he said is, he recessed the court until 2 o'clock, and he said you had 15 minutes to get back there.
Does he know where they are?
Oh, yeah, Molly told him. Molly made a real strong statement.
Can we interrupt you a moment? I'm sorry. If the cops come out here, I think we ought to instruct our people not to resist them.
You know? Sure.
Because we've got some real resistors here, and, you know, they'd tie them in knots if they wanted to.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Sure. Can we get the word around?
Sure.
Why don't you spread it down there at the end?
Huh? Sure.
Mother and father, they'll sweat and they'll say to build you a coffin and dig you a grave. Hush up, my little one, never you be, for we've got a toy that can put you to sleep. Sang the crow.
Where are the rest of the defendants?
I have a motion to make on behalf of the defendants, Your Honor.
I don't think the jury should hear the motion.
You're not going to let the jury hear the motion, Your Honor?
If it is a legal motion, it'll be heard by the judge, not the jury.
The court has lied by saying our justification brief could be argued in public court, and both from the stand and from the brief. In effect, Your Honor, we believe that the court and you personally have displayed yourself, I think, along with the entire judicial system of this country, as the legalized arm for genocide. For these reasons, our four brother defendants have returned to General Electric to stand vigil against crimes being planned every day and to protest the multiplied injustices of this court against hundreds of others.
Your Honor, I think the other four defendants should be here.
An ordered society is the only kind of society that can exist. Those who would make their own rules individually plumping for anarchy, and with anarchy, we'd all be eating each other. We wouldn't have to worry about atomic weapons. All right, I will wait until 2 o'clock. All right, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, we will adjourn. All right, Mrs. Rush, are you prepared to present your defense? No response having been given, Mrs. Rush indicates she does not wish to present a defense. Mr. Hammer? No response having been given, he indicates that he does not wish to present a defense. Sister Ann Montgomery. No response having been given, she indicates that she does not wish to testify. All right. For a matter of record, I indicate that the defendants, Molly Rush, Sister Ann Montgomery, and Dean Hammer, as well as defendant Reverend Daniel Berrigan, are standing with their backs to the court, which I consider an act of arrogance and direct contempt of court. In an abundance of caution, I am going to let them stand there during the closing arguments and the charge of the jury. Bring in the jury. I am advising the body of the court that the four defendants who absented themselves before are going to be brought into the courtroom on instructions from me. And if there is any outbreak or any uproar whatsoever, this courtroom will be cleared. All right. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, we're now at that stage of the trial where you will receive the charge of the court. Now, I will read the instructions and the charge of the jury. No doubt the importance of this trial has impressed itself upon your minds. Be not unduly influenced by the possible consequence of your verdict toward any of the defendants if you should convict them. You must not be guided by sympathy for them.
Now, each of the defendants is charged with the crime of burglary. And in order to find the defendants guilty of burglary, you must find that any and all of the following elements have been established beyond a reasonable doubt. One, that each of the defendants entered building number 9 in the King of Prussia plant on September 9, 1980. Two, that the place where the defendants entered was a building or occupied structure. Three, that the defendant intended to commit a crime in the building or occupied structure. There are in the charge of criminal mischief two elements. One, did the defendant damage tangible property or cause particular owner to suffer pecuniary loss by deception or threat? And two, that the defendant either acted intentionally or recklessly. Now this humming is going to stop or I'm going to clear the courtroom. Do I make myself clear?
How do you find General Electric? They're building genocidal weapons to wipe out all life on Earth. How do you find them?
All right, clear the courtroom. Clear the court! Go on, get him out of here, everyone.
Judge Salas, what happened to the basic argument of the dangers of nuclear weapons?
All right, clear the courtroom.
Hey, Judge, do you get to go to the bomb shelters for the politicians and generals or fry for us and our kids?
Clear the courtroom. Clear the court. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you are the fact finders, and I charge you anything I say is not controlling on you. You are the exclusive judges of the fact. The defendants maintain, because of their belief, their actions were justified. The defendants motion in this case, the fact that they were engaged in the protest, in a sincere belief that they were acting in a good cause, is not alone an acceptable legal defense of justification. Since these and other elements of the defense of justification are without any support in the evidence in the bar and in the case at bar, I instruct you that as a matter of law, certain elements of the defense of justification are absent, and therefore, the defense of justification is not proper in this case. All right, the jury may retire.
Justification in this trial wasn't allowed, so we couldn't use justification as a means for finding him innocent of it.
John Pisa, I was juror number 2 in the Plowshares trial.
Were there any hardliners on the jury?
Yes.
What sort of people were they?
Young. One was a young girl. I can't remember her name now.
What did she do? A young girl?
She wanted them convicted of everything. She was a courthouse employee, and she wanted them convicted of everything, you know, right from that's the way she felt they were guilty of everything.
When the GE employees were on the witness stand.
How did you feel about those GE witnesses?
The GE witnesses we felt weren't credible at all.
We're not?
We're not. Strictly from the fact that none of them had the correct story of the number of people that were in the room. In fact, the two people that supposedly were in there first, one guy said 6, one guy said 7. You know, nobody knew the exact amount, who was there and who wasn't there. None of their testimony really impressed us at all. I don't think anyone was impressed with them. We all felt that what they were trying to do was save their jobs.
Most people didn't know until this trial came out that they were building missiles up there. All that we knew what was being done up there was mostly satellites and underwater experimentations for living underwater.
other than that, you know, nobody knew that. I never knew that there was weapons like that being built up there. I had no idea.
It made us angry that there's stuff like that going on. All of us. That includes the two that were very strict for a guilty verdict.
I don't appreciate nuclear weapons. I don't appreciate nuclear power plants. I feel that if things aren't done, we're going to have a lot of trouble on our hands. Now, I don't feel that it's worth it for future generations not to have anything that we've worked so hard to build up. I feel that if they don't do something soon and they don't get together, we're going to have major problems.
All right, the defendants have chosen not to come in because the public's not in. And they have not been allowed in because of the singing during the charge to the jury and the contempt of the general public to this court and the decorum and their behavior and the noise which was involved in the termination of the charging of the court.
Your Honor, I think the record should show that the defendants are entitled to a public trial. And indeed, the verdict is part of a public trial. I understand, Your Honor, that the defendants are outside the courtroom now, waiting to come in.
Yes, well, unless the defendants will indicate to the court that there will be no outburst or desecration of this courtroom and no outcry, no outburst of any kind whatsoever, then they cannot come in here. Now, if they will agree to do that on that condition, then we will allow them in.
I'll see you.
Very well.
Your Honor, I am authorized to represent that the defendants will sit during the verdict and that their friends and supporters will maintain the decorum that this court expects.
And no singing as well?
No singing, Your Honor.
All right, then, they will be admitted. You may bring in the jury.
Will the foreperson of the jury please rise? In the issue joined between the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the Plowshares 8, how say you on the charges of burglary, criminal mischief, and criminal conspiracy? Guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
You say guilty, and so say you all?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, on behalf of the President Judge Richard S. Lowell and myself, this has been a very long case, a very tedious one. And I think that your jury verdict reflects the careful consideration of the evidence and is well considered.
You hung Christ today.
Judge Salas has just finished the sentencing. He gave four of the men 3 to 10 years in the penitentiary. They were Phil and Dan and Carl and John. He gave two of the men 1.5 years to 5 in the penitentiary. He gave Molly 2 to 5 in the penitentiary, and he gave Ann 1.5 to 5 in the penitentiary. In addition, he added probation time of 5 years for the shorter prison sentences and 10 years for the longer prison sentences to run consecutive with the prison sentences. He revoked bail for all and gave credit for time served heretofore. The sentencings are an incredible miscarriage of justice, and they show how dangerous it is to seek peace in America.